But it's not the story of Jesus calling Peter out. This is a different story, different text. And we all love the story. How many love the story when Jesus calls Peter out onto the waves? And as long as Peter was keeping his eyes on Jesus, you know, he was walking on the water. We all know the story. But the moment he took his eyes off of Jesus, the Bible says that Peter sank. And this is the part that people forget to mention, is that Jesus picked Peter back up out of the water. And the Bible says they both walked back to the boat. And how many know that God is a God of restoration? It doesn't matter if you took your eyes off of him. It doesn't matter if you sank. It doesn't matter if you got overwhelmed by the waves. Jesus' hand is outstretched, ready to restore you, bring you back to a place. How many know the word repentance? That root word for repentance is where we get the word penthouse from. It means, literally, repentance means to restore back to the highest place. So when God restores us, when we repent and our sins are forgiven, God doesn't treat us like a second-class citizen because we messed up. When he forgives us, he literally is restoring us back to the place where we belong, which is a son or a daughter in him. Come on, he throws our sins as far as the east is from the west. He throws them into the sea of forgetfulness, and he posts a no fishing sign, and he says, son or daughter, as long as I am concerned, you are forgiven, you are set free, you are my beloved. That is the Father's view of you. And when we talk about Peter stepping out of the boat, a lot of times one of the stories we can pull out of there is that sometimes we need to step out of our comfort zones into the faith zone to follow Jesus. But that's not the message we're going to talk about today. We're not going to talk about you stepping out. We're going to talk about Jesus stepping in. And so John chapter 6, verse 16, it says this: that evening, Jesus' disciples went down to the shore to wait for him. But as darkness fell and Jesus still hadn't come back, they got into the boat and headed across the lake toward Capernaum. Soon a gale's wind swept across and upon them, and the sea grew very rough. They had rowed 3 or 4 miles when suddenly they saw Jesus walking on the water toward the boat. They were terrified, but he called out to them, "Do not be afraid, for I am here." Then they were eager to let him in the boat, and immediately, somebody say immediately, they arrived to their destination. I find this story amazing, and it's one of the most overlooked stories in the Gospel of John. Here's the story. Number one, let's learn a lesson. Anybody, see, I believe it or not, I grew up on an island. I did, Long Island, but it's still an island. I was surrounded by water on all four sides. And because I lived on an island, there were many people who had boats. Actually, Pastor Ted and Sue had boats in their backyard. They had boats docked there, and we'd go out. 4th of July, we watched the big fireworks show. It was amazing. It was great. But one thing anybody who lives near water knows, you don't do one thing. You don't go out on the water in nighttime, especially if you have a small sailboat. I'm assuming these apostles had. It'd be one thing if you had a carrier or a destroyer, or some big armored boat you want to take the sea on at night, you feel free. But anybody in a small boat knows you don't go out at nighttime. And here's the story of these guys, these disciples, who want to wait for Jesus, but it started to get dark and Jesus had not shown up yet. First key I want to talk to you this morning is sometimes when we're waiting on Jesus and he doesn't show up when we think he should, we start to take matters in our own hands. You see, they were waiting on Jesus, but he didn't come. It was getting dark, and they're thinking, well, we got to go over to Capernaum, so we better go ahead of Jesus because he's not moving fast enough. So because they went ahead of Jesus, they found themselves on a boat in the middle of the sea when a gale wind started to blow. Anybody ever here ever find themselves in the middle of a storm that it wasn't the devil's fault? Wasn't your neighbor's fault, but it was your fault. If you're not raising your hand, then you need to read Revelation chapter 21, verse 8, which says, liars go to hell. Every single one of us have put ourselves in situations that we're blaming the devil for. Come on. I mean, every single one of us have done stupid things. We've gone ahead of God. We thought we can take it into our own hands, go ahead of Jesus, and everything's going to be fine. And the disciples thought the same thing. And here they are. They get in the boat, and suddenly a gale wind came upon them. And the Bible says that the sea grew very rough. I think that's a really nice way of saying they probably peed their pants. Because I've been on larger, all you guys who fish here are actually talented, because all my fishing experience growing up on Long Island was deep sea fishing. You don't need any skill. The captain with his radar brings you to a place where there's a lot of fish. You literally just go over the side and drop the thing in the water. And next thing you know, your thing is bending and you pull it up. I mean, and we called ourselves fishermen. And there was this one time where there was like a storm like miles and miles away, but it was making the water where we were extremely choppy. And the boat was just like, you know what I'm talking about? Thank God I don't get seasick, you know? But there were many people who did and fed the fish, whatever they ate for lunch. And so I'm thinking, could you imagine being these disciples in a little sailboat? And a gale wind, it's a hurricane wind, comes in and makes the sea very rough. They're terrified. Are you following me? But you know what's even more amazing? Out of the fear of being in the middle of a hurricane in the middle of the sea, the Bible says that Jesus starts walking on the water, and they were more afraid of the thing that they see in the middle of the water walking toward them than they were the storm that they were in. Like, that had to be spooky. I mean, if you're more scared of this ghost you think that's on the water than a hurricane that's coming in, you got problems. And you know what happens? A lot of times when Jesus shows up in the middle of our storm, he doesn't show up like a knight on a horse in shining armor, declaring and blowing a trumpet saying, "I'm here to get you out." Sometimes he shows up in unexpected, unseemingly ways that can actually make us scared if our perspective is not right. And instead of allowing Jesus to walk on top of our storms, we allow fear to enter us because we're actually afraid of the very thing that God is doing. This is what happens in many churches in the middle of revival. God shows up, starts doing things that are not in their theological boxes. And we start to get afraid of Jesus because he's not doing something we expect him to do, how we expect him to do it, and in the manner in which we would do it. So when Jesus shows up, number one, you can expect unexpected things. When Jesus shows up, expect the unexpected. I don't know about you, but God has a way of doing things with me and in my life just to prove me wrong. I'll never forget the first time I ever got drunk in the Spirit. You don't understand, I didn't believe in this stuff. I thought it was nonsense, garbage, flesh, carnal, you name it. I'm like, those people are dummies. Sitting in my religious box. And I was at this service, and this minister, John Minor, was preaching. And nobody was even talking about the Holy Spirit. I don't even remember what he was preaching about. All I remember is I turned to Jean. I'm like, "Do you smell that?" She's like, "What?" I said, "I smell wine. Somebody came to church right after. They probably were drinking in the parking lot." I'm like, "Ridiculous." And I'm like, and the smell kept on getting more intense. I'm like, "Well, Gina, I smell." She's like, "Honey, there's nothing. It's in your head." I'm like, "Honey, baby, all of a sudden, now you don't understand, I've never been inebriated in the flesh, so this was an all new experience to me. Are you following me? And all of a sudden, like, my body felt weird, and I started laughing at things that weren't funny, and I had very little control over my extremities. And I'm sitting in the service, and I'm thinking, "Michael, collect yourself. You are in church." And finally, it's over, and this is where I met Corey for the second time. Corey, anybody? Anyway. And I'm literally sitting on the floor, leaning up against the seat like this, barely can keep my eyes open, focus on it. And Corey comes over, he goes, "Hey, Mike, remember me?" I'm like, "No, I don't remember you at all." I mean, I'm completely just inebriated in the spirit. It's kind of like that moment when Peter says, "We are not drunk as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. But rather, this is the gift of the Holy Spirit." Because remember when they said of the apostles in the upper room, actually the 120, they said, "These men must be drunk." And I love it because I've heard it excused and written off as, well, because they were speaking in tongues. Well, yeah, because that's exactly what I think when I hear people speaking other languages. They must be drunk. And you got to remember, the people saying this to them were Gentiles from all over the world. They knew what drunk was. This is why Paul says, "Do not be drunk as the pagans, as the Gentiles," because they knew how to get drunk and have a party, right? So these men who knew how to get drunk and have a party would not think that somebody just speaking another language is drunk. It had to be something a little bit more than just shut it out. You know, you follow me here. There had to be something that just brought these people to a place where they're like, "Yo, these people are drunk." Well, I got to experience that. And I'm sitting there, and in my mind, I'm like, "God, this isn't you." And I remember the guest speaker, he came over and we're talking, and he tried to pick me up because, like, I could not walk. And I put my, he's like, "Don't even touch me, it's transferable. Like, it's coming over to me." I sat there on the floor of the church in Cowdersport for almost 3.5 hours, just inebriated. Well, you know what that did? That made me realize and recheck my theology of what the Holy Spirit can and cannot do. So sometimes when Jesus shows up, when the Holy Spirit shows up, he brings me to places outside of my comfort zone just to remind me one thing. I am God. And I can do whatever I feel like doing with or without your permission. I feel like it's, who was it? Like, was it Jonah? When he's like, "Where were you when I formed the universe? Where were you when I put the stars into their place? And the like, did I need your permission to form everything that you see?" Sometimes when we try to put Jesus in our box, I feel like him saying, "Who do you think you are? Where were you when I was knitting you in your mother's womb? Where were you when I spoke Jupiter and Venus and Saturn in its place? Where were you when I formed the stars in my hands? Do you honestly think you get to tell me what I can do and not?" So here comes Jesus freaking the apostles out so much so they're forgetting about the storm in their life. And finally, he calls out to them. I love Jesus so much because even though I try to limit him, and even though I have so little faith, and even though I put myself in situations that I deserve to suffer the consequences, he still calls out to me and says, "Son, do not be afraid." I don't know about you, but I'm thankful that I have a Savior. Because I'm in need of salvation. I'm in need of saving. And the Bible says that as soon as he called out to him, the apostles were eager to let him in. I don't know about you, but there have been many times in my life where I'm like, "Jesus, I need you to intervene in this situation. I need you to step in." You see, when Jesus shows up, sometimes he calls us out like he did to Peter, but sometimes he steps in. And the Bible says that as the moment Jesus stepped in the boat, immediately, somebody say immediately,
immediately,
they were at their destination. I don't know about you, and I've said that a few times here this morning, because you got to understand, I preach to myself when I preach. Anybody who thinks the person who's ministering the word has got it all right and all perfect and doesn't sin and doesn't, you know, think bad thoughts and doesn't want to flip off somebody, you know, when they cut them off or they don't learn how to drive through a traffic circle correctly or... If y'all think that ministers or, you know, men or women of God are perfect, then you've been deceived and lied to. Paul says, "I am the chief of sinners, but by God's grace." Now, just because I'm a sinner doesn't mean we allow and excuse those things. Come on. we are continually being sanctified, and I want the way I look tomorrow to be greater and more like Jesus than the way I look today. Amen? Amen? But we all still struggle with stuff, and I know that, you know, there are times that Jesus steps into my situation and something I've created for myself, a mess I made that I don't deserve to have cleaned up. And according to the religious standard, I should have to clean up my own mess. You made your mess, you cleaned it up. But Jesus says, hold on here, son. Let me demonstrate my love for you in this, that I'm going to show up in the middle of your storm that you put yourself in, and I'm going to step in the boat, and I'm not going to make you row back. See, Jesus could have done what he did. He could have just, he could have just stood up and say peace, and the storm waves could have stopped, and then they could have just rowed back to their destination. But he didn't even do that. He allowed them instantly to be transferred from where they were to their destination. Sometimes in your life, simply because God is so good and Jesus loves you so much, God will deliver you instantly out of something that you're in, and he will bring you to where you need to be. I am so sick and tired of the religious voice that tells you that you got to work it, and just strive and labor, and maybe if God is in a good mood, and maybe if you've prayed enough, maybe if you've read your Bible enough, maybe if you went to enough church services, maybe if you've sowed enough, maybe if you've fasted enough, maybe if your faith has increased enough, then maybe God will do something for you. But church, yet while I was still a sinner, Christ died for me. The moment you think that anything in your life has to do with you, you've missed the gospel. And it is not because of my goodness or because of my works or because of my effort. It is simply because God is good. Now, you know the flip side to the coin, right? We are a church that believes in balance, not extremes. So yeah, there are times that we got to work out our faith with fear and trembling. Work out our own salvation. There are times we got to put our hands to the plow and we got to do what God's called us to do. But don't think that God does things for you because you earned it. I honestly believe that when we have to work out things in our faith, it's not for God's benefit, it's for our own. He's working something out of us. I'm so thankful that God loves me this morning. So thankful that God loves you. And I'm thankful that when Jesus shows up, he steps into my situations, and suddenly, I'll give you a little testimony. For those of you who don't know my background story, my testimony, I'll give you a little brief thing. When I was younger, I got into legal troubles, and I'll never forget, I'm sitting in this, and after I got into legal troubles, I was given probation. Never do it again. And guess what I did just like a year later? The very thing that I was on probation for. Yeah, that was smart. Yeah. And time out, anybody here about to judge me, may I remind you what Paul used to do? All right. Anyway. So I'll never forget, I'm sitting in a courtroom about to go before a judge to face the penalty for breaking my probation and doing this thing over again, right? And this guy went before me in an orange jumpsuit, shackled at his wrists, and shackled at his ankles. And he stands before the judge, and he was literally guilty of the very same thing that I just did. The judge sentenced him to 15 years. I walk before the judge, and he says, you know what, Michael? We're going to pretend this never happened. We're just going to erase this thing from your past. Let's just don't do it again. Now, you know, I already broke the probation. All right, then I get a letter from the original court that originally put me on probation, and because they can now retry me, because part of the stipulation was if you break your probation, you could be retried for all this stuff. I get a letter from my original court. Guess what they said? You know what, Michael? We're going to pretend this never happened. We're just going to erase this from your record, and now to this day, because I finished my probation, everything was erased. I don't have a record. I don't have any trace of anything on my record. Everything was put away. Everything was cleaned up. Everything was gone. When God shows up, I don't care what kind of mess you got yourself into. I don't care how fleshly and carnal and stupid you were in the moment. I'm here to let you know that when God shows up, everything changes. Now, I will tell you this one thing. You know what he did tell me? That day I came home, literally just relieved of everything I went through. And he says, but Michael, if you do it one more time, you will suffer the consequences of your actions. I was like, all right, Papa. Not doing it again. But here's the thing. What would the religious spirit say? You're a bad boy. You don't deserve to be in ministry. God doesn't love you. And for the next 20 years, we, the church, are going to judge you every time you walk in the doors and hold you to an unrealistic expectation of how you're supposed to act, even though we ourselves don't live to that same standard. We're going to hold you to an unrealistic, unbiblical standard that, thank God, God doesn't hold us to. And even though this man or this woman of God fell, forget about forgiveness. Forgiveness is only good for me. It's not good for other people. Thank God for his grace, but it's only good for me. It's not good for other people. And, you know, forget about the scripture that says, in the same measure I forgive, I will be forgiven. Forget about all those things. See, I'm going to hold a judgment against you. But you know what the Bible says about bitter root judgments, right? That when you have a bitter root judgment against somebody else, you wind up reaping and experiencing the same very consequences of the thing you're holding against somebody else. When you say, how many people here have ever said, maybe you had a bad dad or a bad mom, and they did things to you as a kid you didn't like, and you said, I will never do that to my kids. And what winds up happening? You do the very same thing. That's because you entered into a bitter root judgment. You have now you now put yourself under the weight of that judgment, the measure you forgive. So I don't have to be ashamed of my testimony, because my testimony is when Jesus showed up in my life, he took this messed up, broken person, and he transformed me and created in me a new man, and he gave me a new heart and a new spirit and a new mind. And I am here today not because of counseling. I'm not here today because of 12 steps. I'm not here today because somebody decided to mentor me. I'm here today because Jesus got in my boat. And when he got in my boat, suddenly things started to change. But here's the stipulation. Can I give you the caveat, the key, the trick to all this? When he gets in your boat, will you let him be your captain? See, Jesus is willing to get in the boat, but the question is, are you willing to let him lead? Because I don't want Jesus just sitting in my boat sleeping. I want him at the helm, leading the way. You see, because if I stay the captain, even though Jesus is there, I can still face storms. But when Jesus steps into my boat and he steps into my situation and I say, just like whatever that country singer, Jesus, take the wheel. Carrie Underwood. He takes control of my ship and he knows how to navigate through the storms and through the seas of life, and he can get me suddenly. Something that would have taken me 20 years to get to, Jesus can suddenly, bam, you're there, son. I mean, I don't know about you, but that's good news. So I don't know where you're at this morning. I don't know what storms you're facing. All I know is that Jesus is asking, will you let me step in? Will you let me break through your fear, break through your anxiety, break through your lack of whatever? And will you let me step in? Because, church, this is what I realized as I was sitting in the Netherlands. I'm just going to sit here for a second. This is what I realized. God is about to do something that is so much bigger than any single one of us expect. What God is about to release, even in this region, while we were in the Netherlands, the Lord spoke to the RPN group, and they were talking about redigging the wells of revival here in America. And, you know, we've been doing so much overseas, but we want to focus on the U.S. And in prayer, we were talking about the one well of revival. What well of revival do we start first? Where do we go first? And it was unanimous that the first place we're going to start is here in Olean. That the full resource and power of RPN, as little as that is, or much as that is, I don't know, but we are going to be focusing on redigging the wells of revival in this city. And we're going to be putting together prophecies. This first step we're doing, pulling together all the prophecies that have to do with this region. And the two, I've mentioned them to you before, but I'll say them again just in case there's a visitor here. The two that, the forefront of my mind, one is by Pastor Cho from Seoul, Korea, and the other one is by Kim Clement, a great prophet of the Lord who went to be with the Lord last year. Pastor Cho in 1995 had a vision. He was praying, Lord, and during a fast, he said, Lord, are you holding revival or judgment for America? And while he's praying this, the Lord brought him up into an open vision. And it was an atlas. And the Lord said to Pastor Cho, place your finger anywhere on the map. And he placed his finger, it was North America. He said, place your finger again. And he placed it and landed in Pensacola, Florida. He says, I'm going to start here. And then when he lifted his finger, he saw fire shoot out of Pensacola, Florida. And then little fires shot up all over the country, but they died out very quickly. And then all of a sudden, he saw the New York-Pennsylvania borderline erupt with fire. And from there, it overtook the rest of the nation. He said, this is my plan for America. And if you know, a year later on Father's Day, 1996, revival broke out in Brownsville Assembly of God in Pensacola, Florida. And then fast forward to 2001, 2002, Kim Clement prophesied that the next great revival will come out of the Pennsylvania, New York borderline area, yes. Western New York. That's where it's coming out of. And so we're recognizing and we're seeing what God is going to do. But here's the thing that trips us up. We think, okay, this is what the Lord has been speaking to me, that we think that somehow if revival is going to be birthed in this area, this region, this church in my life, because how many know that revival starts, first renewal comes to the body and then revival comes to the world, that somehow we have to have it all perfect. That, you know, God can't use me if I'm still acting like this. God can't use me if I'm still cussing like this. God can't use me if I'm still messing up. Are you following me? And that we think that somehow we have to perfect ourselves before God can use us. But if all you need to do to encourage yourself is read your Bibles. And you will see God using messed up, broken men and women. How many remember when we talked about Rahab? I mean, she was a prostitute, a Gentile prostitute, who's in the lineage of Jesus. Her name is written in the genealogy in the Gospel of Matthew. I don't care who you are, what you've done, where you've been, and what God is working in and through you. God can use you where you are right now for his glory. Now, he loves you enough, I want to make this disclaimer, not to leave you there. We go from glory to glory to glory, right? God, as we submit ourselves to him, he does the work in our hearts. He deals with sin. He deals with anger. He deals with the things we struggle with. He gives us, instead of our fruit of bitterness, the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Are you following me? But we can't say no to God because we're not ready yet. We have to submit ourselves to God and say, God, I'm ready. And then as we submit ourselves to him, allow God to do internal, personal revivals. Allow God to untap the well of revival that's in your own spirit. Many people here are saying, man, I remember what it was like when I first got saved. I remember how much I prayed, how much I read the Bible, how much I worshiped, how much I loved going to church and loved being in fellowship. But I'm not there anymore. Well, the Lord's answer to the one church who fell, he goes, go back and do your first works. Because what you need to understand is that your relationship, as you redig the wells of God, sometimes you just need to make a commitment, a decision. And whether you feel it or not doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. When I don't feel like loving Gina, when I don't feel like being a husband, when I don't feel like being a father to my children, it doesn't excuse me from the obligations and the covenant that I created before God and man. I've made a decision that this is till death do us part. So whether I feel it or not, right, I'm going to do it. Well, then you got to make that same commitment with God. God, listen, I'm going to push through my emotions this morning. I'm going to push through my feelings of inadequacy, of failure, of all these things, and I'm going to pursue you like I've never pursued you before. You know what? If when I was first saved, I used to wake up early in the morning and pray and read my Bible. Well, if God says one of the keys to refanning that flame is go back to your first works, then I'll start making myself do the things that I used to do out of passion, and I'll just create a discipline out of it. And the more I get into intimacy with you through the discipline of prayer and the discipline, that's right, I said discipline. How many know that there's joy in the discipline? Anyway, so the more I read and the more I pray and the more I start fellowshipping with the church and the more I obey him, all of a sudden, you know what God does? He starts to put in me this fire and this passion. It starts stirring up in me again. And all of a sudden, my 15 minutes of prayer isn't sufficient. I got to go a half an hour, and then I got to go an hour and two. And then, what, my God, where did half the day go? I was just with Jesus. Come on, somebody. And all of a sudden, things start changing. Why? Because Jesus stepped in our boat, and this is the process of him taking us from the middle of a storm to our destination. So this is the end of my message. I only had that one scripture. I didn't even use a sticky note this morning. But because I wanted to prophesy over you corporately as a church. And I didn't really have much. When the Lord spoke to me last night, it was like 8:30. You know, normally with me, when I write a message, the Lord gives me a scripture, and I kind of meditate and, you know, stay on that scripture, and then I study that scripture, and then you know how it all goes. And next thing you know, you have all these great catchphrases and these great sayings that everybody can tweet, and you're really excited because you have something presentable. But then sometimes he just says John chapter 6, and you're like, thanks God. And so I'm praying about John chapter 6 verse 16, and obviously we all know when Jesus shows up, and there were some points made, but he says, I really want you to prophesy over the people because I want you to let them know. I want you to put them on guard and put them on standby and let them know that Jesus is about to step into their boat. So I guess you can forget everything I just said. If nothing else, pay attention to this. Jesus told me by the Holy Spirit last night that he's getting ready to step into your boat. I really feel by the authority of the Holy Spirit, even right now, that this year is going to be a year of suddenlies. It's going to be a year of destinations reached, prophecies fulfilled, dreams made reality. I even declare over you right now the very thing that you have been dreaming for the past 10, 15 years, 20 years, God's getting ready to do it. And it's been no wonder, no surprise that the storms have been even greater than they've ever been in your life. Because sometimes, I believe this, that God puts us in the middle of something great right before he's about to do something greater. And so sometimes it feels as though the attack is the greatest right before. So if you've been feeling, I'm in the middle of a storm, things are going horribly wrong, every time I turn around, something else bad is happening, everything else is going wrong, my health, my finances, my family, I declare by the Spirit of the Lord that Jesus is getting ready to step into your boat. I come against the storms, I come against the fear, and I declare by the authority of Jesus Christ that he's getting ready to step into your boat. And listen, here's the thing. He steps into your boat, and what happens? Immediately things turn around. Come on, somebody shout, suddenly. Suddenly. I'll step out on a limb here. I don't normally like doing these kind of things because if nothing happens, then you look like a fool. But I feel like the Lord's saying between the next 8 to 12 days, there's going to be suddenlies in specific lives. 8 to 12 days. So what's today? Today's the 12th. So by the 20th to the 24th, get ready for God to start shifting, turning around, moving things. I'm declaring favor in the courts, legal systems. I'm declaring that illnesses, diseases that you've been suffering your whole life, healed without anybody even laying a hand. Jesus is stepping in and immediately. I'm declaring families that have been broken, relationships that have been broken, marriages and spouses that have been broken, wayward children, they're coming home. I declare by the Spirit of the Lord. I declare that financial problems, lack, the poverty mentality is going to be broken in the name of Jesus. I declare more than enough in Jesus' name. I declare dreams that have been dreamt, visions that have been had, destinies and purposes that God released over your life even many years ago. I declare, first of all, before you start to see the turnaround, you're going to start to dream the dreams that you used to dream. You're going to have the visions over again. You're going to be woken up in the middle of the night. You're going to start to have these dreams. You're going to hear the voice of the Lord. Come on. You're going to start to hear the word of the Lord speak to you even in the midnight hours. I even hear the Lord saying, get ready for your sleep to be disturbed. I'm going to wake you up in the midnight hours, and I'm going to speak to you again, says the Lord. I feel like there's been some business transactions that people cheated you in these business transactions. Things were done to you wrongly. They were promised one way and done another. I declare by the Spirit of the Lord that there's going to be reconciliation for that, that God is going to bring back everything the enemy stole plus more. I just feel in my spirit that there's going to be phone calls being made to you saying, hey, this was promised. We're going to make this right. We're going to make this right. I even feel the Lord say land. Land will be given over these next few months. There's going to be land that is going to be released to my people. Church, listen, if this isn't you, you better start to increase your faith and believe that if God's doing it for somebody, he's going to do it for you. I feel like land is being released to his body. Land is being released to his people. Resources are about to be released to his people. I declare by the Spirit of the Lord. Yeah, Lord. Okay. I declare barren wombs are going to be open, both in the natural and in the supernatural. I declare wombs that haven't been able to produce and reproduce shall in the name of Jesus. I declare the very first command that the Lord spoke over humanity, be fruitful and multiply. I release that prophecy over you right now. I speak to your womb and I declare be fruitful and multiply in Jesus' mighty name. I declare that children, the fruit of your loins, children are going to start to call you up and say, Dad, Mom, I know I've sinned against you, I've sinned against God, and I've sinned against heaven. I know I've done you wrong. I'm calling you up to repent in the name of Jesus. Will you forgive me, Dad? Will you forgive me, Mom? Can we have a relationship? And let me tell you something, even if you were the cause of the broken relationship, God is about to restore. He's about to go before you and do some things on your behalf, things that you've been praying for, things you've been believing for, even over the past 6 months. God said, I'm getting ready to do. In this season, I'm getting ready to do in this season. I don't know why. I'm sensing, I just see a large building, like a commercial building. It looks like an older school or something, but I just see a larger commercial building. It's already built, but God is about to release. I don't know what this is. It might be somebody watching on live stream or somebody sitting here, but there's a large facility that God is about to release to his church that's going to be used as a place to bring in the harvest, to take care of the widows and the orphans. God, I just see this large facility that God is about to turn over and then supernatural funds to restore it, to get it up to code and get everything that is necessary and in place for God to do what he's about to do. I'm here to let you know that God is releasing buildings. I declare God is releasing facilities. I declare that God is releasing new homes. Come on, somebody. I declare by the Spirit of the Lord, this isn't just some mumbo jumbo. I'm not just thinking things off the top of my head. I'm releasing what I hear the Spirit saying. And if God says it, if he gets in your boat, you better believe it's going to happen. I'm here to declare, come on, I'm not going to ask you to come up and bring money. And if you sow your seed, God's going to do this. This is simply because God loves you. He's giving these things to his people because he loves you. There's nothing necessary from you this morning. Nothing you got to give. The only thing you got to release out of your body this morning is faith and believe it. I see there's been problems with jobs that have been causing issues with shifts not lining up and lack of pay raises and keeping you locked down or the unavailability to find a job. I'm even here to let you know people who deserved a raise and haven't had a raise for over 20 years, I'm declaring by the authority of Jesus, you're going to start to find favor in the workforce. I declare that if you own a business, there's going to be greater increase of customers coming into your business. If you're starting up a business, people are going to start to find out about you and people are going to be seeking you out. Come on, somebody. And I even believe that right now in the name of Jesus, debts are going to be paid off. I hear the Lord saying large debts are about to be paid off. Church, you don't understand. I don't flow like this. You know me. But listen, this is just something I feel the weight of the Holy Spirit on. I hear the Lord saying there's going to be debts of $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 that he's going to supernaturally, I declare student loans, mortgages are going to be paid off in the name of Jesus. That's a me too. Come on, somebody. I receive that in the name of Jesus. Man, okay, God. So I don't know why, but Pastor Bill and Eileen, there's something about Sarah's heart that the Lord has just been putting on my heart. You don't understand. There's weight on this right now. I don't know if anybody else can feel it, if anybody else bears witness in their spirit. But there has been a holding pattern over Sarah's heart for too long, says the Lord. So, Lord, we break every spirit of prevention. We bind every spirit of prevention that would hold back the answer, the will, and the purpose of God from coming forth and coming into place for Sarah's heart. We declare that house, Lord, actually, this is what I hear the Spirit of the Lord say. That house is not going to hold any children, Pastor Bill, the one in Portville. He's about to open up the new home for you. And the moment that ground gets broken, the moment that there's going to be an influx of children, it's going to be overwhelming at first. And the Lord says that as soon as you build, you're going to have to build on, says the Lord. And the Lord is also raising up, I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying this, the Lord is raising up people to come up under and hold your arms up. The Lord is raising up those who will dedicate their life to furthering on and carrying on the mission and the heartbeat of Sarah's heart. So I declare in the Spirit of the Lord that every promise, every dream, every vision that God has given you is coming to pass in this season. I'm not talking about 5, 10, 15, 20 years. You're going to see it, and you're going to see it soon. I declare by the authority of the Lord, by the end of this year, you will see greater things than you've ever seen before. I declare by the Spirit of the Lord, by the end of this year, you shall be in the new home, says the Lord. By the end of this year, there's going to be an increase of giving like you've never seen before. There are going to be people who are going to catch on to the vision, and people who even abandoned the vision are going to start to come back on board, says the Lord. And he's going to prove himself. And the moment people start to sow, he's going to release, he's going to do, and the Lord's going to be faithful in this season for what you've been holding on to, says the Lord. Yeah, absolutely. Where's the microphone? We're not done, so keep this going. Pastor Bill just has something to release.
What you just said, I know, is true. I just spoke to a pastor last week about what we're doing, about building the home up in the up on the land that was donated to us in Hinsdale. It's going to hold around 30 children. And I was telling him about that, and he says, I want to go to my council and see what we can do to bless you. Well, he instant messaged me the other day that they met, and the council met, and they're going to be giving us $16,000 to get started on this project.
Come on. Come on. Come on. If God is doing it for Pastors Bill and Eileen, he's doing it for you. Come on, somebody lift your hand and say, me too, God. I declare in the name of Jesus that out of this house shall come the entrepreneurial spirit, new businesses that will provide income, that will provide jobs, that will stir the economy in this region shall come. New ideas, greater ideas. Here's the thing that I find amazing. When you look at Joseph, and Joseph was processed and positioned before Pharaoh. And the word of the Lord was this, that there's a famine coming. But before a famine, there's going to be an increase. There's going to be a great harvest. So the Lord sent a man named Joseph to go to Pharaoh and say, what we need to do is we need to prepare the storehouses. And we need to start putting away into the storehouses, because there's something coming that people are going to be in need of, and that God is raising you up, Pharaoh, you up, Egypt, to be provision for the world. I believe that God is going to raise up Josephs right here in this room, who not only are going to go to the Pharaohs of this area, but that they themselves will become provision. They themselves, and I'm not just talking about, and I believe, number one, that primary, I know a lot of people don't like to talk about money, because a lot of people don't like them touching their gods, but, and don't worry, we're about to talk in the month of March about stewardship, giving. I don't care what you believe, what you've been told, tithe is a command, and it has nothing to do, I don't care if your heart's in the right place. When Jesus says, if you obey me, follow my commandments. If he commands us to tithe, that means it's not up. The obedience to give is not up to you. You must follow. And the thing that talks about your heart being the right place, he's talking about offerings. Tithe was commanded. Offerings are up to your heart. And we're going to talk about that later this month. Because listen, you will never have a harvest if you eat your seed. If you are continually eating your seed, you will never see a harvest. And we're going to talk about that another day. But I believe the first thing that he's going to start releasing to his faithful ones is going to be financial blessing. But there's also something, because listen, this is also going to go into healing and miracles and signs and wonders. The world will look for answers in the church. God, listen, our nation is divided like never before. There is brother pitted against brother, sister against sister, mother and father against son and daughter. Are you following me here? The only thing that is going to bring this nation back together and back under the banner of Jesus is the church living like the church, being a living, breathing revival, bringing the ministry of reconciliation and healing to all those who are hurt and abandoned and abused and broken and lost. It is time for the church to rise up, declares the Lord, and it's time to be the church. So I declare that in this season, I'm gonna wrap it up. If we can have, is there anybody here? Somebody, Rudy, somebody play an instrument. This is how I like to flow. I need music. That's how I flow. Yes, I do need sleep, but I don't flow in sleep. Actually, if you want to get biblical, you can say, you know, the Bible says that in the last days shall pour out my spirit upon all flesh, your sons and daughters shall prophesy, your young men shall dream dreams, your old men shall see visions. The only way for me to dream a dream is if I'm asleep, so I must take a nap to fulfill the word of the Lord. Y'all can use that some other day on somebody. So husbands, when your wife says, honey, get off the couch and help me out. Lord, honey, I'm just fulfilling scripture right now. I got to dream some dreams and see some visions. Come on. Come on. Anyway. And I this is kind of the last thing, and I'm kind of feeling it lift, but there's going to be a supernatural healing of broken hearts and offended spirits. Even now, Lord, release it. Father, pour out on your church right now. Erase offense. Heal bitterness and brokenness. Undo the shame and the hurt. Agreements that we've made through bitter root judgments. Father, we ask that right now, by the authority of your Holy Spirit, you would start to sweep through this room. Let's do this. If you are in this place, you need healing for offense. You need healing for broken hearts, for bitterness, for rejection, whatever it is. Anything in that circle, I want you to come up. We want to lay hands on you. Father, I want to release forgiveness. I even feel like the first step to receive is to release it. And so we're going to release forgiveness. People that have been hurt by the ones we love. People have rejected us. People have lied to us. People have betrayed us. I just need God to come in and just touch my heart. I need Jesus to show up and step in my boat.